I grew up with great optimism in Nigeria as my country. From kindergarten through junior secondary school, we were regularly made to recite a song, "Children are the leaders of tomorrow." It wasn't just a song, it was a legendary battle cry that psychologically prepared us for the daunting task of leading Nigeria and serving as safe agents. We eagerly anticipated that future, full of morale and hope. The future where we would lead our country. The future where our voices mattered, where our dreams were valid, where we could dare to change our country, where the voice of the common Nigerian mattered, and where our fathers would hand us power and not banish us from its corridors. I was proudly Nigerian. I wanted to be president. I believe the government had a plan for youths, and that there were systems in place to help us emerge and compete favorably with our mates all over the world. But then, adulthood woke me up to the reality of being a Nigerian in Nigeria. Like most Nigerian youths, I am anything but proud to be Nigerian. I am too scared for my life to speak and demand justice, and I have watched the leaders I elected become my own colonial masters. October 20th, 2020 broke my heart. I am today like every ordinary Nigerian faced with the choice of either getting violence as a response for demanding peace or embracing violence in exchange for a peaceful response from government. And I keep wondering, will the youth's voice ever matter in Nigeria?
Wow. You know, first thing that caught my attention was when you talked about the youths are the leaders of tomorrow. Mm. You know, I think we also need to get back to that era where we start reciting that theme, where we begin start shouting that youths are actually the leaders of today. But again, even if you say come out and say youths are the leaders of today, I think the only thing to do, the major thing to do, is to start enforcing this sense of responsibility, not shifting responsibility to tomorrow, waiting for a particular time when you will become a leader before you start taking action. Because really, it doesn't stand for you to say youths are the leaders of tomorrow in today's Nigeria. We are still waiting for tomorrow to come.
Mm. I agree. I think it's a big lie. The people that designed that song, either they did it out of ignorance or they intentionally did it just to keep us down. There is nothing like tomorrow. Tomorrow will never come. I think youth are the leaders. That's just what it is. They are the leaders of the moment. Not even the leaders of... They are the leaders of the moment, right? Kingsley said something very instructive of how the people who were supposed to... who were entrusted with the power have held on to it. I think we are our leaders. Not, I don't want to say our leaders. We find it difficult letting go of power. We want to be in charge. We want to control things and stay on it. There's nothing wrong with putting controls in place. But to the degree that we are not able to pass on that baton to someone else, it becomes a problem. He talked about the October 20, 2020 heartbreaking experience. One, it was like the whole country slapped young people to the face and they said, we don't want you to talk again. That October 2020 is significant, and it's not just, it's going to stay in the history of Nigeria. Young people were told to shut up and never to talk again.
You know, I see a lot of emotions in what Kingsley wrote in that. Kingsley, can you talk a little bit about, because while you were just citing that, I could see emotion, because I know for someone like you who really wanted to be, or rather, who really wanted now, because I'm not sure you still want to be a president, but then, I mean, coming to a place where the people who are supposed to, nurture you to achieve that dream now seem to be the people that are now, like,
trying to suppress,
killing the dream, exactly.
You know, it's growing up in Nigeria has been a very painful experience, especially psychologically. You know, I was very patriotic. If you knew me earlier than now, I was pro-Nigeria. I never had the intention of leaving the shores of Nigeria. And I had an experience in 2013 that solidified that conviction, right? Mm. I was a captain of the national team, president's debate team, and we were going to represent Nigeria at a world tournament in Turkey. We just landed in Istanbul International Airport. And on our way to the arrival segment, they demarcated everybody that came out from our flight into three. They said, Americans and Europeans this side, others this side, others including Africans, Ghanaians, and then they said Nigerians this side. They separated Nigerians. As if that was not enough, others were allowed smooth passage into Turkey. Nigerians were taken to a separate room where they had, I don't know what it is, but it was a robot, scan us, including our eyes and all that. I felt so stigmatized. The stereotype was too much. And I didn't understand why the average Nigerian would be singled out for such stereotype, right? So it gave me that impression that the Nigerian life doesn't matter, even outside Nigeria. Because one thing is to leave Nigeria, but when you leave Nigeria, Nigeria follows you.
Exactly.
Because the moment you say, I'm from Nigeria, everybody automatically becomes skeptical. So I was passionate about Nigeria because I felt I could change things. I was going to change something. But the truth is that I'm no longer as patriotic, you know? Why that October 20th event touched me so much is that I could have been there that day. So there is a possibility that I would have been dead by now.
I was there on that day.
Okay, you were there.
I left in the evening just because I needed to go and, you know, do some school runs. I was there up until the evening. I just went to do some school runs. Exactly the same. In fact, my neighbor was there while the shooting was going on.
Okay.
He left, he ran away, and you know, well, his sister forgot her slippers, one leg of her slippers. So I know, I felt that October 20 is as real, because I could see some people that were, you know, pictured dead, and I can remember seeing them on
the point.
You will never really forget what happened on October 2020. And I'm saying this because it's really showed that the voice of over 60% of our population do not really count, right? Young people here will like make up 60% of our population of over 200 million people, and we can't really put our voice together, and it matters. It's really something to really worry about.
This thing you said reminded me of something. Raymond mentioned 60%. I think a big problem in Nigeria is that young people don't know how powerful they are, because the power of the oppressor is derived from the oppressed. I will use the election scenario as a case study. Young people aged 18 to 30 make up at least 65% of the voting population, right? So during elections every year, during general elections, we complain of looting, we complain of rigging of election and all that. But look at the real picture and you understand that young people are the problem. Who are the vast majority of people who refuse to come out to vote? Young people. Who are the vast majority of people who sell their votes for stipends? Young people. The talks they bring up to maybe hijack and stuff ballot buses and unleash mayhem on INEC officials are young people. The security agencies they used to hoodwink party agents to endorse fictitious election results are young people. The election officials that collect bribe to rig the election and falsify election results are young people, mostly core members. So you understand that the problem is not the old man sitting in Abuja. The problem is the young person who doesn't know how powerful he is and who has allowed himself to be used as a weapon to terrorize him. So what I think is that young people in Nigeria are not educated enough. You know, there's a difference between being schooled and educated, right? The vast majority of young Nigerians are schooled. Only few are educated, because education is about empowerment. It empowers you and shows you this is what I have a right to do and this is what I can achieve, which is why I think the government does not have a robust plan for education. I keep saying it. This government keeps weaponizing illiteracy and poverty, because as long as those things are in place, they will continue to get away with almost anything they want to do.
Kingsley, I think I agree with you, but I think everything is systemic. I was watching the screen, there was the last show that held. I was sitting down there and watching it, and they talked about there is this picture they dug out from the internet about how someone said you don't need the missiles and all of that to destroy a nation. All you need to do is to pause the education. What they did, they took history out of schools. We don't even know. We never even knew that some people fought for certain freedom until NSAS.
I think it's very, very important that people know where they're coming from, and it's from what, starting from what Kingsley said, when we don't really have an understanding of where we are coming from, we don't know our history, And so we can't also make informed decisions about where we, you know, are going to. And it's one of a very, very big problem because we don't know where we're coming from. We don't even know what to say to where we're going.
Absolutely.
The advocate is better with your participation. It's now time to share some of your viewpoints on issues discussed here. On last week's advocacy, CEO OK says, it seems easy to say, why can't we vote good people into leadership positions? The truth is, power is still in the hands of the same club members, and the platform to represent will never be extended to any outsiders. So Nigerians should rise up to what? Please. Election is not and was never free and fair in Nigeria, but is still massively rigged. Perhaps it's better to understand that Nigerians have long lost hope and are resigned to wait for when the end will come. Follow us on social media platforms on Facebook, Plus TV Africa, The Advocate Nigeria, or on Twitter and Instagram at Plus TV Africa, The Advocate, which hashtag The Advocate NG. To catch up with previous broadcasts, go to plustvafrica.com/theadvocateng. After the break, Raymond is differentiating between positional leadership and functional leadership. See you.